Good morning. Let's solve a relatively simple 3-point charge electric potential energy problem and then make sure we understand the physics.
Flippin' physics.
Bobby, please read the problem.
Okay. 3-point charges charge Q1, which is equal to positive 6.0 microcoulombs. Charge Q2, which is equal to negative 5.0 microcoulombs. And charge Q3, which is equal to positive 4.0 microcoulombs, are each located 1.0 meters from one another, forming an equilateral triangle. What is the electric potential energy associated with this 3-point charge system?
Thank you, Bobby. Bo, give me some thoughts about this problem and how to solve this.
Sure. We know the electric potential energy of the 2-charge system, which consists of charge 1 and charge 2, equals the Coulomb constant times charge 1 times charge 2, all divided by the distance between charges 1 and 2. And actually, we know it is the same equation with different subscripts for the electrical potential energy of the 2-charge system, which consists of charge 1 and charge 3, and the electric potential energy of the 2-charge system, which consists of charge 2 and charge 3. And we know energy is a scalar, so to get the total electric potential energy of the 3-charge system, all we have to do is add the 3 electric potential energies together, which is just adding all 3 of those equations together. Yep.
That is correct, Bo. Billy, please finish the problem.
Absolutely. Well, in order to substitute in numbers, we need to convert all the charges to coulombs because the units on the Coulomb constant, little k, are newtons times meter squared all over coulomb squared, which means we need the charges in terms of coulombs and not microcoulombs. Charge 1 equals 6.0 microcoulombs, which we multiply by 1 coulomb over 1 times 10 to the 6th microcoulombs because there are 1 million microcoulombs in every coulomb. And that means charge 1 equals 6 times 10 to the negative 6 coulombs. We could do the same thing with charge 2 to get negative 5 times 10 to the negative 6 coulombs, and charge 3 to get 4 times 10 to the negative 6 coulombs. And we know all the distances between the charges equal 1.0 meters, so R12 equals R13, which equals R23, which equals 1.0 meters. And we know the Coulomb constant equals 9.0 times 10 to the 9th newtons times meters squared all over coulomb squared. So we can substitute in all of those numbers into the equation for total electric potential energy Bo gave us to get negative 0.27 plus 0.216 minus 0.18, which equals negative 0.234 or negative 0.23 joules with 2 sig figs.
Correct, Billy. Thank you. Now, this is how the math works. However, we are not done. My job is to help you understand the physics, not just make sure you can plug in all the numbers. I guarantee you that you are going to run into physics problems which go beyond just plugging in the numbers like we just did, and instead ask you questions which require that you understand what all those numbers mean. Are you ready?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Sure.
Okay. Recall that potential energy is stored energy which depends on the relative positions of various parts of a system. To find the electric potential energy of the 3-charge system, let's start with charge 1 by itself as a single object in the universe which has 0 electric potential energy because it takes more than one charge to store electric potential energy. If we add charge 2 to the system located at an infinite distance from charge 1, the 2-charge system of charge 1 and charge 2 still has 0 electric potential energy. You can see this conceptually because the charges are infinitely far from one another, therefore they have 0 effect on one another. Also, that is how electric potential energy is defined. Essentially, as a scientific community, we have decided to identify the location where the electric potential energy for a 2-point charge system equals 0 as when the 2-point charges are infinitely far from one another.
And you can see it mathematically because that initial distance, R12, is equal to infinity, and anything divided by infinity equals 0. Right, Mr. P?
Correct, Bobby. Now, to move charge 2 at a constant velocity to a final distance R12 from charge 1, it requires an external force to do work on charge 2, and that work is equal to the change in electric potential energy of the two-charge system made up of charge 1 and charge 2. In other words, the work done by the external force changes the electric potential energy of the charge 1 and charge 2 system by an amount equal to the Coulomb constant times charge 1 times charge 2 divided by distance R12. But that is just the electric potential energy of the two-charge system made up of charge 1 and charge 2. Now we need to add charge 3 to the system. Bo, please talk through what it would mean to add charge 3 to the system using what I just did as a model.
Okay, well...
We know energy is a scalar, so we can just add electric potential energies together, right?
Sure.
So we can just figure out the work required by an external force to move charge 3 at a constant velocity from an infinite distance from both charge 1 and charge 2 to a distance R13 from charge 1 and a distance R23 from charge 2.
Okay.
At the initial position, charge 3 is an infinite distance from both charge 1 and charge 2, so the initial electric potential energies of both two-charge systems are equal to 0. The two-charge system of charge 1 and charge 3, and the two-charge system of charge 2 and charge 3, again, they have 0 initial electric potential energy.
Right.
So to move charge 3 at a constant velocity to a final distance R13 from charge 1, it requires an external force to do work on charge 3, and that work is equal to the change in electric potential energy of charge 1 and charge 3, which is equal to the Coulomb constant times charge 1 times charge 3, all divided by distance R13. And to move charge 3 at a constant velocity to a final distance R23 from charge 2, it requires an external force to do work on charge 3, and that work is equal to the change in electric potential energy of charge 2 and charge 3, which is equal to the Coulomb constant, little k, times charge 2 times charge 3, all divided by distance R23.
And as I said earlier, electric potential energy is a scalar, so we can just add all of those electric potential energies together to get the total work done by external forces on the three-charge system, which is equal to the total change in electric potential energy of the three-charge system.
So basically, the electric potential energy of the three-charge system is equal to the work it takes an external force to move charge 2 at a constant velocity from infinitely far from charge 1 to a distance R12 from charge 1. Plus the work it takes an external force to move charge 3 at a constant velocity from infinitely far from both charges to a location, which is a distance R13 from charge 1 and a distance R23 from charge 2. That's it?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you, Bo.
Okay. But how does that help me understand the physics and not just plug in numbers?
That is a fair question, Bo. Remember, potential energy is stored energy which depends on the relative positions of various parts of a system. For example, as I lift this book at a constant velocity, I am applying an upward external force to the book, which does positive work on the book and puts gravitational potential energy into the book Earth system. The book Earth system now has more gravitational potential energy, which means it has more potential to be converted to other forms of energy. In other words, when I let go of this book, the force of gravity on the book, which is internal to the book Earth system, does work to convert the gravitational potential energy of the book Earth system to kinetic energy of the book Earth system. However, if the book starts here, and I instead lower the book at a constant velocity, the external force I'm applying on the book is still upward. However, the displacement of the book is downward. And I am therefore now doing negative work on the book, which is removing gravitational potential energy from the book Earth system. And when I let go of the book Earth system has less gravitational potential energy to convert to kinetic energy.
But when the book is moving down, why is the force he applies to the book upward? The book is moving down, so the force he applies to the book should be down, right?
The force he applies on the book is upward as the book moves down, because the force he applies on the book keeps the book moving at a constant velocity.
Yeah, if he did not apply an external force to the book, the force of gravity would be the only force acting on the book, and the book would accelerate downward.
Okay, sure. Thanks.
You are welcome. But my question is, why does that make the work done by the external applied force on the book negative?
Because work equals force times displacement times the cosine of the angle between the direction of the force and the displacement. The applied force is up and the displacement is down, so the angle is 180 degrees, and the cosine of 180 degrees is negative 1.
Oh, right. Thanks.
You are welcome.
Now, the same thing is true if I instead have a system which is composed of only two point masses, mass 1 and mass 2. In order to move mass 2 farther from mass 1, an external force must do positive work on mass 2, which puts gravitational potential energy into the two-mass system. And that gravitational potential energy has the potential to be converted to other types of energy, kinetic energy being one type of energy. In order to move mass 2 closer to mass 1, an external force must do negative work on mass 2, which removes gravitational potential energy from the two-mass system. The system now has less gravitational potential energy to be converted to other types of energy. Now, the same thing is true if I instead have a system which is composed of only two-point charges, charge 1 and charge 2. However, because two masses are always attracted to one another, and two charges may be attracted to one another or repelled from one another, it is helpful if we specify the signs of the charges. Let's start with charge 1 and charge 2 having charges of opposite signs, which means they are attracted to one another. When this is the case, the two-charge system behaves much like the two-mass system. In other words, to move charge 2 farther from charge 1, an external force must do positive work on charge 2, which puts electric potential energy into the two-charge system. And that electric potential energy has the potential to be converted to other types of energy, kinetic energy being one type of energy. And in order to move charge 2 closer to charge 1, an external force must do negative work on charge 2, which removes electric potential energy from the two-charge system. The two-charge system now has less electric potential energy to convert to other forms of energy. However, if charge 1 and charge 2 have charges of the same sign, they are repelled from one another. Now, in order to move charge 2 farther from charge 1, an external force must do negative work on charge 2, which removes electric potential energy from the two-charge system. The system now has less electric potential energy to be converted to other types of energy. And in order to move charge 2 closer to charge 1, an external force must do positive work on charge 2, which puts electric potential energy into the two-charge system. Now, going back to the problem we solved to start this lesson. Because charge 1 and charge 2 have opposite signs and are attracted to one another, the external force acting on charge 2 to bring it closer to charge 1 does negative work on charge 2 and removes electric potential energy from that two-charge system. In other words, an external force removed 0.27 joules of energy from the charge 1 and charge 2 system. So, if charge 1 and charge 2 are the only two objects in the universe, charge 1 and charge 2 would accelerate towards one another, and the final kinetic energy of the two-charge system would have 0.27 joules less than if the two charges started an infinite distance apart.
Okay, so the negative 0.18 joules of energy in our solution represents the fact that the two-charge system of charge 2 and charge 3, which are a distance of 1.0 meters from one another, has 0.18 joules less electric potential energy than if charge 2 and charge 3 were an infinite distance from one another. And if charge 2 and charge 3 are the only two objects in the universe, and they were released from rest 1.0 meters from one another, they would accelerate towards one another, and right before they collide, they will have 0.18 joules less kinetic energy than if we were originally released an infinite distance from one another. Right?
That is correct, Billy.
And the positive 0.216 joules of energy in our solution represents the fact that the two-charge system of charge 1 and charge 3, which are at a distance of 1.0 meters from one another, has 0.216 joules more electric potential energy than if charge 1 and charge 3 were an infinite distance from one another. And if charge 1 and charge 3 are the only objects in the universe, and they start at rest 1.0 meters from one another, they would accelerate away from one another and have a total kinetic energy of 0.216 joules when they finally get an infinite distance from one another, where all their electric potential energy has been converted to kinetic energy, right?
That is also correct.
So the total electric potential energy of the three charge system is negative 0.23 joules. That means that if these three charges are the only three objects in the universe and they start at rest in a configuration where they are each 1.0 meters from one another forming an equilateral triangle, charge 1 and charge 2 would accelerate towards one another. Charge 2 and charge 3 would accelerate towards one another. And charge 1 and charge 3 would accelerate away from one another. All of that would happen simultaneously. But their charges are not all the same magnitude, so their electric forces would not have the same magnitude. And we do not know their masses, so we do not know what the final configuration of the charges would be. All we know is that the final kinetic energy of the three-charge system will be 0.23 joules less than if the three charges had started an infinite distance from one another rather than in the equilateral triangle.
Yep, that is all correct.
Okay.
Right. I do understand it is all a bit hypothetical. However, it is really important to understand all of this, in addition to being able to plug in the numbers. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoy learning with you.
Did we just spend almost 13 minutes to understand the physics behind a problem that took us only 3 minutes to solve?
Yes. Yes, we did.
Absolutely. That is the flipping physics way.
Yeah, that it is.